So we have David Reed, who is a mammals curator with the Museum of Natural History. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd also like to thank the Open Access Publishing Fund. So I'd like to think I'm an old hat at publishing in an open access forum, but I'm not really sure. My first open access publication was in 2004, and that was PLOS Biology. And it served us really well for a variety of reasons. And currently, about half of the publications that come from my lab, we try to publish either in an open access journal specifically, or at least under an open access option under existing print journals. More and more of those print journals are now coming up with those policies. So the Open Access Publishing Fund has allowed us to leverage, well, we always ask in our NSF proposals for funding for open access, and I explicitly tell the National Science Foundation when I write those proposals that this work is funded by taxpayer dollars, and taxpayers ought to have easy, relevant, or ready access to this work, and they've been very supportive of that, and we're glad of that. But I can only ask for so much from the National Science Foundation, and so having something locally here like the Open Access Fund allows us to leverage those dollars and allow them to go a lot further with publications that we normally wouldn't have had the ability to put in an open access medium. So in my research, we study mostly mammals, or mostly primates, but a wide variety of other mammals, and we actually study these nasty little parasitic lice that live in their fur, because we can use these parasites to understand the evolutionary history of the mammals, as well as things like human migration patterns. So the lice that humans carry, we've carried with us as we've expanded all around the globe. And because of that, these little parasitic nasty creatures in their DNA have a written history of our evolutionary history. And so we can tap into that by looking at these parasites. And I guess because parasites like lice are really icky, and human evolution is a topic that a lot of people are interested in, our work, we've benefited from a good bit of public press about our research, which is great, and it happens from time to time. And in one particular paper that we published in 2007 that I'll talk about, open access publishing in particular really helped to let a lot of people know about the research that we're doing, and so I'll talk about that really quickly. So what we showed back in 2004 in the first paper that we did in open access is that if you look at the evolutionary history of primates and these parasitic lice that live on them, we find that they've been co-evolving or speciating together in time for over 25 million years. So basically, when you think about the lice that humans carry on them today, we've had them ever since we've been human, and the closest one relative to ours is found currently on chimpanzees. And so they've been evolving together. So an author at the New York Times, a writer, Nicholas Wade, has been thankfully fascinated with our research for a long time. And when our paper came out in 2007, he wrote a story about our paper. This was looking at the other louse that humans carry, the crab louse or pubic louse. And so he wrote about this too. And thankfully, he talked about the fact that our paper was an open access paper and mentioned that specifically in the journal where it was published and the link to that. And, you know, anytime you get your research published in the New York Times, that gives you a lot of publicity and a lot of press, and that was great. But what happened this time that was even more important is that bloggers picked it up, and it occurred on Slashdot within a matter of hours of the New York Times article coming out. And bloggers went crazy with the story, and they were really good about putting in the link to that article. So if this had been published in a place where they didn't have access, it wouldn't have had quite the meaning to the general public. They wouldn't have been able to go to the journal itself and write comments about the paper, and they wouldn't have been able to download the original article themselves and read it for themselves. So the one in 2007 was published in BMC Biology, and it was thankfully a very highly accessed paper. It's third on this list, and after about 30 days, it had over 3,200 downloads. None of my other works, probably all combined, will ever have 3,200 pairs of eyes looking at them. And the thing that was really remarkable to me is that the reason why the views were so high is because the general public was looking at this pure scientific research that they typically wouldn't have had access to in the past. They paid for it. They ought to be able to see it, and they ought to be able to do so very, very easily. So that's one of the things that I really like about open access publishing. I like all of the other things, too, but to think that the general public can get such easy and rapid access to the work that they initially probably paid for in the first place, I think is really gratifying. So in our case, this paper has been cited quite a lot more often than it probably would have been otherwise. We're just really thankful for the Open Access Publishing Fund and hope that it's sustainable and is supported here at the university, but also at places like the National Science Foundation and other places where we get our funding from principally. So thank you very much.